Welcome to the Sounds of Encouragement, the place for creatives to find encouragement and support to help you stay motivated, creative, and inspired to use your craft to more fully impact your community. Thank you for tuning into this episode, and don't forget to subscribe so you get notified of future episodes. If you find value in these podcasts, please share with friends or colleagues. To keep this production ad-free, please share your support at www.buymeacoffee.com/encouragement and share a one-time gift or check out the member levels. I'm your host, Melissa Slocum, and I thrive on encouraging other creatives through teaching music, small business coaching, podcasting, and so much more. Find out more at www.musicgrow.com and subscribe to be part of a growing creative community supporting one another. Don't forget to check out the links in the show notes. And remember, I'm here for you, so you can be there for those who need you the most. Enjoy the show. Pam Asberry, Master of Music, has over 40 years of professional experience as a music educator, adjudicator, performer, recording artist, speaker, author, composer, and arranger. A BMI artist, she has released 9 solo piano albums to date, and her music can be heard on Spotify, Pandora, Apple Music, Sirius XM, and elsewhere. Described as a new age solo pianist of uncommon melodic grace, insight, and heartfelt intuitiveness by Jonathan Widran of the JW Vibe, Pam Asberry is an award-winning performing artist and composer who combines contemporary, new age, and classical sounds to create music that is alternately melodic and graceful, dramatic and powerful, peaceful and hypnotic. Classically trained from the age of 7, she completed a master's degree in piano performance and piano pedagogy and maintains a private teaching studio in Lawrenceville, Georgia, offering both virtual and in-person lessons in piano, clarinet, music theory, and composition. She has played concerts across the United States and abroad, and her twin passions are sharing her music and the stories behind them with listeners around the world and inspiring others, especially young people, to find their own joy in music making. Please welcome my guest, Pam Asberry. Welcome to Sounds of Encouragement. My name is Melissa Slocum, and I am so happy to welcome my guest today, Pam Asberry. Pam, thank you so much for being part of the podcast.
It's my pleasure to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
Absolutely. So Pam and I know each other. We're locals, and we have known each other for about 10 years that I've lived, actually more than that, here in the Georgia area. And we are part of the same local MTA, and we've seen each other around at a lot of events. And I've always been so impressed, Pam, by your studio and your students. And you have just become a wonderful composer and performer in our area as well, and even well beyond this area. So what a privilege to be able to work with someone so talented and to be able to have you as part of the podcast this season. I want to talk a little bit about encouragement and what encouragement has looked like in your life up to now. You know, a lot of us start off and we get encouragement from a lot of different places and at different points in our lives. Can you talk about some of those important people or some of those important moments of encouragement in your life and how, what that has done to help you continue in your career?
Oh gosh, I mean, my parents, my teachers, all of my teachers, I had sort of a succession over the years. My college teacher, especially, at that point, I had reaffirmed my commitment to be a teacher. And so not only was she my piano teacher, but she was my pedagogy teacher. She had also raised a family. And so she was very supportive all the way up until she died of of the work that I did teaching and raising a family and wow. juggling all that. And yeah. So I've just been very blessed over my life to have a lot of encouragers.
And was there ever a point where you doubted and said, you know, maybe this isn't for me, but someone or something helped you kind of turn that around and pivot back into like, yes, this is where you need to be?
Not really. I've always been kind of single-minded about it. It's sort of family legend that I had my first piano lesson and I told my parents that I was going to be a piano teacher when I grew up. And I really never wavered from that. People tried to talk me out of it.
Yeah.
At times, people felt that I might be better suited to be an accountant, or I might be more financially secure if I became an engineer. But those things really didn't interest me. If I hadn't been a piano teacher, I probably would have been an English teacher. Definitely felt called to be a teacher. Now, there was a moment when I first started college that I thought I might be a band director because I also played the clarinet and actually went to college on a clarinet scholarship. But all it took was one semester of brass techniques. And I said, this is not for me. Just no thanks. And I really didn't want to teach. I really wanted to be a private teacher, and piano was always really my love. So no, I've kind of been on this very straight path my whole life.
Which is really wonderful, because that it seems like that's becoming more and more rare for a lot of people in a lot of industries. But that is a wonderful segue, though, to my next question, which is, how have you gone about discerning in your life what is encouragement for you and what is expectation? Like someone else saying, oh, well, maybe you should do this. And you sort of alluded to that with people sort of discouraging you away from a career in music to do other things. How have you gone about like responding to those kinds of expectations, or how have you decided, well, what's actual encouragement for me and what's just someone else's expectation?
Yeah, well, I think I'm a sort of a pleaser. I've been a pleaser throughout my life. And so no doubt there are times when I have bowed to other people's expectations. But I also, at this point in my life, for sure, I have a really strong sense of myself and what my goals are and where I'm headed. And so when you have that, it's a lot easier to resist those external pulls. And so I don't think I could be easily dissuaded at this point.
Yeah. And I think that rings true for a lot of people that I've interviewed over the last few years, is that strong sense of self and that strong sense of identity and clarity about where I'm going is what helps people kind of stay with what they want to do rather than being influenced by what other people might say or suggest. So, you know, we all made it through pandemic life. And we're those of us who are here and are still teaching. What was it that kept you hopeful, kept you creative, kept you going through pandemic life?
I was very fortunate. My youngest son was still at home. So he was with me. And I think I hated living through it, of course. It was a terrible time, but I'm very optimistic by nature.
Yeah.
So I just felt like everything would be okay. And I had my son. That was very special time with him, time that I wouldn't have had otherwise, because until we went into quarantine, we were kind of like two ships that passed in the night.
Sure.
Because I was working and he was going to college, and we rarely even had a meal together. And during COVID, we had practically unlimited time together. His classes were online and my students were online, and we had three meals a day together. And so he was just a nice companion. And I can look back on COVID and actually find a lot to be grateful for. Things like that, time with my son that I wouldn't have had. I even wrote a song about it. It's called This Time With You. And so I think just trying to count my blessings as we walked through it. Other than the fact that excuse me, other than the fact that we were isolated, my life didn't really change all that much. You know, I was still teaching and I was still composing and doing all the things that I do. So just kind of made the best of it.
Yeah.
Like we all did.
Yeah, exactly. And I know that as you were composing, and we're going to hear one of your pieces in just a little while, was music something that helped you continue to stay positive, stay hopeful, stay encouraged through that time? Or was it helping you process your emotions or whatever was happening for you at that time? What was the role of music for you during that time?
Oh, all of the above. As a teacher, I was aware that my students were very grateful for that interaction and were finding great solace in music. And I was glad to be able to provide that much of a sense of normalcy for them. As a player, I had more time to practice because I wasn't so running around like a chicken with my head cut off, like I often do. And as a composer, you know, I definitely used music to process my thoughts and my feelings and my emotions. I wrote a whole album. Unraveling is my COVID catharsis album, where I wrote music about the things that I was experiencing and my feelings from the beginning to the end. And so music was a great comfort and release for me during COVID.
How does, you know, this wasn't in the list of questions that I usually provide, but I'm always curious to know, you know, you can't get through very much of life without going through hardship and hard times. How have, you know, in terms of the hard times that you've been through, and I don't know all the ins and outs, but I know you've been through some things. How has that influenced your outlook and, you know, how you accept and receive, but also give encouragement? Because some people, they go through hard times and they just become very bitter and very closed off and very negative. And that doesn't seem to be the case for you. What has, I guess, how has that worked in your life?
I think I've just made a conscious decision not to let hard things make me angry and bitter. It's really a conscious decision. And, you know, I'm confident in the knowledge that strength, you know, that strength comes from challenges. So I wouldn't be doing some of the things that I'm doing today or be the person that I am today had I not experienced those hard times and survived those challenges. So I think it's really just a conscious decision not to let those things destroy you and to let them work in you to make you a better person. Hopefully.
Yeah, I love that. And that's a great segue into that next question is, you know, what advice do you have? What encouragement do you have for others who might be at a place where they are struggling in their lives right now or in their teaching or whatever they're doing?
Yeah, I mean, just hang in there. This too shall pass. There are peaks and there are valleys and it's just part of life. And I think it's harder for younger people maybe because they haven't had as many of the peaks. And when you get down in the valley, you think, you think you're never going to be able to crawl out. But all things come to an end, good things and bad things, and you just have to just keep going. And I think it's helpful to look outside too, because this is sort of a cliche, but no matter what kind of negative experience I'm going through, there's somebody else who's going through something much worse. And so sometimes when things are the toughest, that's the time to look outside and see if you can find somebody else to help. And it kind of puts your own problems into perspective, I guess.
Yeah, I love that advice, because, you know, quite often, we have colleagues and we know friends and family members and other people who have a hard time reaching out at that most difficult time. And what a great reminder to sort of get out of our own self and our own head and take a look and see what else needs done, who else needs help, what other things we might be able to do. Because I think that's the moment when it's the hardest, and yet that's when it's most needed. So I appreciate that. That's great advice.
I think that's why we're here, to help each other. Yeah. And sometimes it's so easy to get caught up in our day-to-day and inside our own heads.
Yeah.
And I think social media makes it hard too. We're always playing the comparison game. And when people will come up to me and they'll comment on things that I'm doing that they've seen on social media. And I say, listen, I promise you, it's not as good as I make it look on Facebook.
Right.
So I think we kind of have to remember that too. We all, our social media is this world that we create and put our best face forward. And that's what, you know, that's what we have to do. That's what I have to do as a performing artist. But my day-to-day life is not particularly glamorous or exciting, and, you know, but it's wonderful. It's good. And I'm just very grateful for all of it, the good and the bad.
Well, and I think that's what makes the good so good, is because, you know, when you are, you know, like, I know you just got back from a recording session, you know, and when you do get to go enjoy that time, it's that much more beautiful. It's that much more, you know, rewarding, just because you can have gratitude for it. And, you know, that's not my everyday. That's not how I live every day. Right?
No. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Can I ask, you know, it occurs to me that, in terms of composing, that's not something that's been part of that I'm aware of, that's been part of your journey for your whole life. When did you actually say, oh, you know, I have music inside that I need to share?
Well, I have always been surrounded by creative people.
Mm-hmm.
And in the early 2000s, I began to make the acquaintance of some of these solo pianists and composers. I've been listening to George Winston and David Lawns for many, many years, but I became personally acquainted with some of these artists, inviting them to come to Atlanta and play concerts. And I would go to dinner with them, and people would find out that I was a pianist, and they would ask me about my own compositions. And I said, I don't write music.
Yeah.
I play other people's music. I don't have a creative bone in my body. And one year, it would have been 2016. I was on a cruise with a group of creative solo pianists. There was an internet radio station called Enlightened Piano Radio. It no longer exists, but a group of artists went on a cruise, and they played concerts on the ship, and I went as a friend. I had good artist friends who were nominated for various awards, and so I went as a fan and as a friend. And one night, I was sitting with my good friend Kathy Oakes over a cocktail, and we were just talking, and I repeated my story about how I'm not a creative person and I don't write music. And she said, I predict that within a year, you will have an album of solo piano music out in the world. And I laughed at her, but she really planted a seed.
Yeah.
And I came home from that cruise, and even though I had taken stabs at writing music in the past and never gotten anywhere, something was different. I just sort of let go of that story that I had told myself and embraced a new possibility. And within a couple of weeks, it was actually my son's 21st birthday, I finished my first piece. It took me several visits to the piano and probably, you know, several hours, wrote the notes down on manuscript paper. But I had my first composition. It was called Monterey Morning, and it was based on a memory of a time that I spent in Monterey, California. And because I love cruises and had been blessed to visit many beautiful tropical places, I decided that my first album would be sort of a collection of musical postcards based on places that I had been, beautiful places that I had, beautiful beaches. And sure enough, within a year, after I had three or four pieces done, I sent them to Kathy, little iPhone recordings, and another artist friend who has an internet radio station. And I said, "What do you think? Are these any good, or should I just quit while I'm behind?" And Kathy was super encouraging. And David Neveu said, "You know, I would, if you had professional recordings, I would put a couple of these on the radio station." And so I stuck with it, and I went out to Sedona and recorded my first album. And now it's, what, 6 years later, and I have 9 albums out in the world, and 4 more recorded as of last weekend. So
wow.
The floodgates are open.
Yes.
And so that's another message that I really like to share with people. Yeah. I think we all have self-limiting beliefs, and we tell ourselves what we can't do.
Yes.
For whatever reason, are we afraid to fail? Are we afraid to succeed? I don't know. But I think it's really important to stay open and not to talk yourself out of things, because if, you know, I could have spent my whole life that way, and I would have missed out on so much, getting to know myself on a much deeper level, you know, meeting so many wonderful people, traveling, having all these great experiences, if I had just kept lying to myself.
Yeah. Yeah. I love that story. And I am so, you know, happy that you were willing to share that, because I agree. You've said it so well that, you know, we often limit ourselves, and sometimes it just takes that one person to see something and plant that seed, but we have to be open to it. And I think that is wonderful encouragement for everybody that's watching or listening, is to just be open and not limit ourselves to what we think we can't do, but just to try to explore, because you just never know what might happen. And, you know, I love where you are now. And speaking of great music, we're going to head over and we are going to listen to some of your top 5 musical selections for encouragement. And I love your selections. I was having such a great time listening to these last night. All of these songs will be linked in the show notes, so we encourage everyone to go and listen to the full track of every one of these songs. They are incredible. I'm going to share screen here, and we're going to listen to your first song that you would like to share. This is, here we go. This is from the Gabe Dixon Band, All Will Be Well. We can only play about a 10-second clip, so I'm going to play this, and then I'll talk about it on the other side.
All will be well. You can ask me how, but only time will tell. All will be well.
Oh, I hate to stop that, but go listen to the whole track. It's a wonderful, beautiful song. Talk about it.
Well, it's just, I discovered Gabe Dixon a few years ago. He's he has his band and he also does solo stuff. And I just, I'm a big fan of singer-songwriter. I told you yesterday that, you know, it's funny, I don't really listen to a lot of solo piano music or even classical music, even though I love it, because that feels more like work to me.
Yeah.
And I'm also very, I find lyrics to be very, very powerful.
Yeah.
And so that's just a really upbeat song. There's a line in there, it's all will be well, even after all the promises you've broken to yourself.
Yeah.
And it's just kind of that thing that I was saying earlier, where you just, yeah, you get through it and you get to the other side and everything's okay. So I love that song.
Yeah, it's such an encouraging message. And I also, you know, love to know, like, when these songs entered your life, what point at your life did you discover this particular song?
You know, this would have been probably about 10 years ago-ish.
Okay.
I don't remember when it came out, but I was on the tail end of raising children and kind of figuring out what my next chapter would be.
Yeah.
And so it just happened at a good time in my life.
It's a great song. Go listen to the whole track if you don't already know the song, especially. But if you know it, you'll be comforted by it all over again and be inspired by it. The next song that we're going to share a clip of is one of my favorite bands, Mumford & Sons. And this is their song, After the Storm. We're just going to play a little clip. Here we go.
With no more tears and love will not break your heart. But dismiss your fears, get over your hill and see.
Oh, I have to stop it there. Talk about this one, After the Storm.
I discovered that song probably, I don't know, more than 10 years ago. I was relatively newly divorced and dating some and, you know, getting my heart broken over and over again. So that was kind of my consolation after breakup song, okay. I guess. But it really does have a much bigger meaning and much, much bigger applications. Yeah. And I still find it, I just think it's hauntingly beautiful. And, you know, there's definitely a theme here of you get through the hard thing and everything's going to be okay.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. You know, and if you haven't heard that song, go listen to the whole track. The vocals are really incredible, as always. But what a great song. I hadn't heard it probably in like 15 years or so. So I really appreciated being able to listen to the whole thing. And you know, what a such a powerful message throughout the song, no matter what you're going through.
I don't think that was one of their big hits necessarily.
No. No.
It's kind of like a B-side track, but I think it's one of their best.
Yeah, yeah, I would agree. All right, we are gonna take a little bit of a hard left turn here and switch over to another great band, Kansas. And also, this is not maybe the most familiar, most famous Kansas tune, but this is a clip from The Wall. Here we go. Oh, go listen to all four, almost 5 minutes of that. It's a wonderful ballad. Talk about that one.
It is. Yeah, I discovered that one many years ago. I've been a Kansas fan forever and actually caught their Left Overture tour recently.
Oh,
they're still as great as they ever were, if not better.
Wow.
And that song's just always meant a lot to me. I was probably in high school when that came out, and that was kind of my mantra. But yeah, and again, not one of their big hits, but just a very powerful song that meant a lot to me at the time and still does.
Yeah, you know, because there's so much good imagery, but also like musically, it's really a wonderful ballad to go listen to. There's so much great instrumentation, you know, and it's just, it's wonderful Kansas, You know, again, not like one of their most popular songs, but a really one. If you've not been a Kansas fan, I really like that song because it just, for me too, goes back to like that 70s era, early 80s era of, you know, there was a lot of good hard rock, but then also a lot of great ballads. And that's one of the great ballads that I think never really gets heard anymore. All right, we're going to move to this is also a wonderful selection. We're going to change direction here again. This is Yo-Yo Ma and Alison Krauss. Alison is singing the Wexford Carol, accompanied by several musicians, most notably Yo-Yo Ma. Here we go. We're just going to hear a 10-second clip.
There you will find this happy morn, a princely babe, sweet Jesus born, with thankful heart and joyful mind.
Oh, I hate to stop this. It's so gorgeous. Go listen to the whole thing.
I start listening to Christmas music about the 1st of October. I love Christmas music, always have. And that song, I did a solo piano arrangement of that song on my first holiday album, which is called Thankful Heart, Joyful Mind, after the lyric in that song. And I just absolutely adore that performance with Alison Krauss and Yo-Yo Ma. It's just one of my favorites. And there's actually a whole album of, I can't remember that what it's called, but it's a holiday album, and it's Yo-Yo Ma with Alison Krauss and then many other artists. They do collaborations, and it's a terrific album. So if you like Christmas music, definitely check that out. You'll love it.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, her voice is so pure, and obviously his playing is so amazing. And everything else in that instrumentation is just so beautiful. What a wonderful presentation of it. You know, and it is, you know, the lyrics too are so uplifting and so, I guess for me, calming and affirming and just like, oh, yeah, it is joyful and this is. It's just that kind of feeling when I listen to it.
Yeah, it's yummy.
All right, the last tune that we're going to share is just unfortunately only a 10-second clip of one of your own pieces, one of your own works here. This is called Metamorphosis. And go listen to the whole, not just the whole track, but we'll let you talk about the whole album too. But let me play this clip from Metamorphosis. Go listen to the whole piece. It's beautiful.
Yeah, so that's actually the orchestrated version of a solo piano piece that is from my Unraveling album, my COVID album. And that piece depicts the going into the cocoon during COVID and then the emerging a completely transformed creature. Because I don't know about you, but before COVID, there were many things that I completely took for granted, didn't give a second thought, you know, just being able to go to a concert or play a concert, or go out to dinner with friends, just things that it wasn't even on my radar that they could possibly ever be taken from me, and then they were gone. So that little section that you played is kind of like the little butterfly wings trying to get out, but then the transformation in the end. So I'm a changed person, but we all are changed people. But like I said earlier, I don't think it's all bad.
Yeah, and I love the imagery of, you know, the butterfly, the cocoon and the butterfly and the idea of that metamorphosis. So appropriate, so beautiful for what we've all been through. You know, if we allow ourselves to accept struggle and hardship and stay true and are able to get through it, you know, with those we love, we will come out changed and we will come out more beautiful if we allow it. It's hard, you know, and we don't want to diminish anyone's struggle and anyone's pain or anything like that. But, you know, it's a beautiful reminder, especially this song, of that transformation and the possibility and the hope, I think, that comes from, you know, staying here on the planet and making it through and keeping things going, because there is beauty that waits on the other side for all of us.
Yeah. And, you know, we all suffered loss. We all lost people. Yeah. And it can't be for nothing. You know, yeah. You just have to try to find meaning in all of it. And I think that's really important.
Yeah. And it's, I think, also music like yours and you being able to share your music and your gifts that also are what help other, you know, the rest of us get through some of those hard times and remember that there is hope, remember that there is another side. And so thank you for sharing your gifts, your talent, your creativity, and being willing to be open to that in the first place, you know, that 7 years ago, and just letting that become unlocked for you and sharing that with the rest of the world. What a beautiful legacy, what a beautiful impact, what a beautiful way that you've contributed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Before I let you go, is there any other encouragement that you would like to offer, or anything else that you would like to share with those who are listening or watching today?
You know, if you're going through a rough time, just hang in there. It's going to get better. And don't be afraid to be who you are. Dig deep. Stop telling yourself what you can't do and start doing it. that's really it.
Amen to that, because we never know what tomorrow brings. Where can people find all of your great music? And I know, you know, not only do you have great albums for people to listen to, but you also sell sheet music as well. So where can people find all the great music that you create?
So you can listen on all the streaming platforms: Spotify, Pandora, Apple Music, Amazon Music. I do have CDs for sale. They make great coasters, Christmas ornaments. I don't know. I'll even autograph one for you. But everything is available for sale through my website, which is pamasberry.com. You can get physical music. You can get digital sheet music.
Yep.
Physical sheet music. I have songbooks and also individual PDFs. People seem to enjoy playing my music. Students like playing my music. Most of it, I would say, is sort of a mid-intermediate to early advanced level. So most of it's not terribly difficult. And it's all the places.
Yeah. And I will also pitch too that, you know, your music makes a great gift for any students who might be graduating or celebrating a birthday. What a wonderful way to gift a student with some new music by a contemporary composer that is just gorgeous. So I invite you to go to Pam's website and check out all that she has to offer there. Pam, what a wonderful interview. What a wonderful time spending this hour with you and just being able to share a little bit about encouragement and share some music and things that have encouraged you along the way. And thank you so much for encouraging those who are listening and watching. And what's next for you? Where are you headed next? What do you have coming up?
Oh my gosh. So many things. I just finished the recording session, as I mentioned. So I'll be releasing new music. The first piece will be a piece that I wrote for my son and his fiance, who are getting married in October.
Oh,
it's
yay!
It's a wedding present, and that song is called "With All My Heart." So that'll be coming out soon.
Okay.
And just lots of new music on the horizon. I am also employed at Piano Works, which is a piano store in Duluth, Georgia. And we've got some special guests coming over the next couple of months. And so lots to look forward to there as well. So life is busy, but life is good.
Yes. And you are always out performing at different places. So again, go to Pam's website if you want to find a house concert or a local performance or anything else. But keep following her on socials as well so you can find out about all of her new music and new releases. Pam, thank you so, so much. This has been a pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Yes. All right. So thank you all for tuning in to this episode of Sounds of Encouragement. Remember that if you need encouragement of any kind, you can reach out to me at soundofencouragement@gmail.com. That does it for this episode. We thank you for tuning in. Take care of yourselves. Thank you for listening. Please click on the show notes to learn more about my guest and to listen to their top songs of encouragement. If you have found value in these podcasts, please share the podcast with those you know, leave a positive review, or support the show at buymeacoffee.com. Sounds of Encouragement is a podcast production of Music Grow LLC, part of growing musicians and teachers everywhere. Sounds of Encouragement is hosted, produced, and edited by Melissa Slocum. To get in touch, contact soundofencouragement@gmail.com. You can also find Sounds of Encouragement on Clubhouse. Drop in weekly for a dose of personal encouragement. Theme music by Melissa Slocum and Steve Tressler. Music mixed and mastered by Steve Tressler. Thank you to Steve Tressler and Christina Lopriori, who encouraged me to do this in the first place. And remember, I'm here for you, so you can be there for those who need you the most.